from?
Patna, sir. Indira Gandhi National Party.
All right.
Okay, sir. I'm starting, sir. Informant mother and reliable information. My patient is Laushan Kumar, 14 years old male boy, studying 6th standard, belongs to lower socioeconomic status, from Bagalpur, brought with complaints of loose discoloration of the skin and mucous membrane since birth and excessive precordial activity since 6 months of age and syncopal episode at 8 years of age and shortness of breath and exertion since last 2 months. My patient was born full term normal vaginal delivery at hospital.
Hello? Yeah, can't hear. Okay.
My patient born full term normal vaginal delivery at hospital with birth weight of 2.5 kg without any perinatal complications, without any history of consanguineous marriage in the family, developed bluish discoloration of the skin and mucous membrane since birth as observed by the mother, which increases during exertion and relieved by the rest, without any history of cyanotic spells and squatting episodes. There is history of excessive precordial activity since 6 months of age in the form of forcible visible pulsations present at the left side of the chest, which are in series in onset and gradually progressive, increased by exertion and relieved by rest, without any post-palpitation diuresis. These palpitations are associated with recurrent lower respiratory tract infections from infancy, 1 to 2 episodes per month, requiring injectable medications, relieved after 7 to 10 days after treatment, with history of fever, cough and expectoration. Pore intensity decreased after 4 years of the age. There is history of suppressed sex cycle and sweating during the feeding during infancy. And there is history of physical underdevelopment compared to other siblings with history of poor weight gain as observed by the mother, with normal social and language developmental milestones. There is history of loss of consciousness at 8th year of age for 10 minutes without any history of postictal confusion.
At the age of how much?
8 years, sir.
Okay.
8 years of age, for which without any postictal confusion, no abnormal movements and bladder and bowel incontinence, and relieved by rest after 10 minutes. There are no further episodes, similar episodes of loss of consciousness after that, for which they consulted the local doctor who advised surgery for some cardiac problem, but not undergone due to financial constraints. Child is apparently alright without any no flesh complaints after that. 5 months back, he undergone corrective repair surgery, after which his bluish discoloration decreased. Apparently alright for 2 months, after which he developed shortness of breath and exertion, insidious in onset, initially during heavy exertion and climbing 2 to 3 stairs of NVHA class 1, which gradually progressed to shortness of breath present even during daily activities and climbing 1 to 2 stairs of NVHA class 2 since last month. Since 1 week, he had history of arthropneia, his shortness of breath increased during lying down position and relieved by the sitting position, for which he was admitted in hospital and kept a tube insertion via the right side of the chest. After that, the shortness of breath is relieved after 2 days.
Sorry, say that again. What was that? After admission, what was done?
Intercostal tube, sir. The tube inserted via the right side of the chest. Intercostal tube was inserted.
Okay.
And this is not similar complaints in the family. There is no history of maternal.
No. Don't mention this here. Okay.
Okay.
This does not come into the chief complaints and the history related to that. Okay. So if you have any other things, you have to tell me about the history part of it. Then we'll take it.
There is no history of any fever and drug intake during the antenatal period to the mothers.
That again comes in the other part of, not into the history. This comes into the personal histories, okay? Or maternal history, yeah.
Okay.
So anything rest of the history is there, or you completed the history part of it?
History part of it, this is the mother.
Okay. So just summarize the history with the chief complaints first.
Okay. 14-year-old male boy with history of cyanosis since birth, without any history of cyanotic spells and squatting episodes, with history of palpitations and recurrent lower respiratory tract infections and failure to thrive, with one episode of syncope, operated post-op status with intracardiac repair, followed which developed dyspnea of insidious onset, which is gradually progressed from NVHA class 1 to class 4.
Okay. Now, couple of things. One is, when you talk about the history, you are talking about blues discoloration in this patient on exertion. Correct? Hello? Yeah. When you gave the first history, you spoke about bluish discoloration of the child from birth, which increased with exertion. Now, in a newborn child, when it is present since birth, where is the exertion?
Taking any excessive feeding, there is a chance of exertion, sir.
Yes. One is when the patient, the child is crying, or the other is when the patient is getting feeds. Okay? These are the only one which are exertional symptoms in a child, in a baby. You have to mention that bluish discoloration at birth, which was either increasing on crying or feeds, if you are able to elaborate from the contact person. Yeah? And then when the child grows beyond 4 years of age, or maybe about 2 years or 3 years, when he starts walking, then you talk about increase in the bluish discoloration with exertion. But as a child, till 1 year of age, it is no exertion for the patient. It is basically related to crying and feeding habits. Okay? Now, you have given a history of bluish discoloration since birth, that is cyanosis in birth. Okay? And at the same time, the patient has got history of
palpitations and recurrent.
Palpitations and you said something else also, one third part, like failure to thrive. Yeah.
Failure to thrive, sir.
Correct. Failure to thrive. When you say failure to thrive, what are the things which take into consideration?
If there is the failure to weight gain, more than.
Yeah. Failure to thrive is lack of weight gain as per the criteria. Yeah. Then?
And a recurrent lower respiratory tract infection history also there, sir.
Yeah, lower respiratory tract infection, which you continue as a part of the failure to thrive. Yes. What assets? What other things?
Probably I'm suspecting like a cyanotic.
No. We are talking about failure to thrive. What are the other things you are continuing? Failure to weight, gain weight, repeated respiratory tract infections, and the third one is what? Your milestones.
Milestones, sir. There are apparently normal social and language milestones.
Yeah, whether they are delayed or whether they are not delayed, they come into the part of the failure to thrive. Now, when you talk about a patient who has got cyanosis since birth, has got failure to thrive, okay? And then patient coming with no history of squatting or syncope, and patient is operated and then having shortness of breath over the course of time. Now, what is the thing which is coming to your mind on the basis of history only? Wherein you have to take into consideration the patient has got history since birth, yeah, which is increasing on activity or exertion. Patient has got palpitation and failure to thrive. And patient has got history of repeated respiratory tract infection. Just to enumerate, what is the category of repeated respiratory tract infection in children?
Category.
When will you say that the patient has got repeated respiratory tract infection?
If the according to old definition, it is more than 6 episodes per year requiring injectable medications and requiring hospital admission, it is not injectable,
requiring antibiotic therapy antibiotic therapy, yeah. Okay, what is the recent one? Now
recent one, more than 3 episodes of LRTI.
It is come down to anything which is involving lower respiratory tract infection. So you must remember that anything respiratory tract infection initially was not categorized as lower respiratory tract. It was 6 respiratory tract infections, okay, in the 6 months. Whereas now it is specifically categorized anything 3 or more lower respiratory tract infections. All right, which require either injectable or admission for the same. Okay, injectable antibiotics, sir, one, or the same.
One doubt, yeah. Sir. Yes. Are we including 6 in these 3 LRTI? Can we include?
It is only lower respiratory tract infection which is accepted as the repeated respiratory infection. Okay, 3 or more. Upper is not considered as this thing. Okay, which is otherwise also quite common in children. Okay, so they are not considered to be related to the heart problems. All right. Okay. So Suresh, you have a patient who has got cyanosis in birth, correct? Which is increasing with the activity of failure to thrive, and has got repeated respiratory tract infection. Possibility. The other symptoms we will take little later, that is your syncope and the other part of it that he underwent operation. I am talking about only on the basis of history. What are the things which are coming to your mind?
Yeah, sinuses present since birth. It is a congenital cyanotic heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow conditions.
Yeah.
Parallel circulation or admixture lesion, sir. In parallel circulation, it is most probably because of the transposition of great arteries or torsion being an anomaly. In admixture lesion, single ventricle.
When you talk about TGA, you have to specify TGA. TGA does not mean that it is only with increased blood flow. Okay. TGA means you have to categorize what type of TGA.
Transposition of the great arteries.
Type
without pulmonary stenosis.
Yeah, what is the type? What is the classification of DTGA?
With pulmonary stenosis and without pulmonary stenosis.
That's right. One and two, correct?
Yes.
What about atresia?
I don't. With pulmonary
atresia. What is the classification? Anybody classification of DTG?
The DTG with intact septum, DTG with VST. And
that's right. You have to consider all these things, no? Because DTGA is a categorization depending upon whether the patient has got a interventricular septal defect. One pass. And the second thing is, what is the status of the pulmonary blood flow? Okay. So on that basis, the classification of DTJ comes. One is tell me, how does the patient survive? Because these are two parallel, there are two parallel circulations, correct?
Yes, sir.
One is the pulmonary circulation, correct?
Yes,
now, for the patient to survive, you have to have some communication between the two.
Yes.
Correct? So, what is the association between the patient who has got a DTJ and no VSD? How does the patient survive? With what?
With patent ductus arteriosus.
Yes, PDA.
Yes.
What is the other one?
With the
interatrial communications.
Sorry?
Interatrial communication.
That's right. Interatrial septal defect. Okay?
Okay.
On the basis. Whether the patient is going to survive or not will determine the other two. The second category comes with a patient who has got a VSD, and then depends upon whether the, what is the pulmonary vasculature, means pulmonary blood flow rather. If you have a pulmonary, both the categorization of pulmonary atresia and pulmonary stenosis come into one class. And those without pulmonary stenosis, that comes in the second class. Okay? So when you talk about this type of DTGA, it is DTGA with ventricular septal defect, by and large, without pulmonary stenosis. Correct? In this patient, we are talking about. So DTGA is not only the classification which you have to talk about. DTGA with VSD with no pulmonary stenosis or large pulmonary blood flow. Okay, that is one.
Yes.
Correct or not? Tosic being DORV without pulmonary stenosis. Yeah?
DORV without pulmonary stenosis.
Yeah. Tosic being an RV. What other things?
Admixture lesion like total anomalous pulmonary venous connection and single atrium without pulmonary stenosis and single ventricle without pulmonary stenosis and the truncus arteriosus.
See, when you talk about these situations, no, all those things should be clubbed together. For example, when you talk about a patient who has got cyanosis in birth, what are the situations wherein the blood flow is going to be increased in such patients who are born with cyanosis at birth? The first and the highest, as you rightly said, comes DTJ with a VSD with no pulmonary stenosis, or close hand in hand goes tosic being anomaly, that is DORV without pulmonary stenosis. The third comes single ventricle with detransposed great vessels with no pulmonary stenosis. These are all categorized as one group. Okay?
Okay.
You understand? These will come with pulmonary vasculature which is increased. That is one part of it. Then you come lower down, TAPVC comes little lower down. Okay, TAPVC, as we discussed the other day, usually the cyanosis is there at birth, but usually it goes away and it is not a very evident sign. It is a part of the cyanosis at birth, but little lower down as far as categorization is concerned. Which is the other one which should come higher up?
Hypoplastic left heart syndrome.
Hypoplastic left heart syndrome, yes. Commonest, another thing which is come, but little lower down. What is the other one which comes?
Tricuspid
atresia. That's right. You must consider these common things with first, no? Tricuspid atresia, again, which type?
Tricuspid atresia.
Tricuspid atresia. 1B and 2B.
Okay, now that you're talking about tricuspid atresia, tell me the classification of tricuspid atresia. How many types of tricuspid atresia do you have? One is depending upon the relation of the great vessels, the normally related great vessels, the D transposition of great vessels and the L transposition of great vessels. Correct?
Yes.
Correct or not? In tricuspid atresia, these are the three categorization of tricuspid atresia on the basis of normally related great vessels, D transpose great vessels and L transpose great vessel, isn't it?
Okay.
With a tricuspid atresia. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah?
Yes.
So now we are talking about tricuspid atresia with normally related great vessels. Which are the situations wherein you will get a significant amount of cyanosis at birth? Are you going to get it in that
pulmonary edema? If there is a Ashish said type A lesion like a pulmonary edema, there is significant sign of cyst.
Yeah, but then we are not categorizing those because we want patients who have got large pulmonary blood flow, isn't it? So we are talking about a different entity here, not the stenotic group.
Okay, sir.
So what is the tricuspid atresia, which are large pulmonary blood flow, which is going to give rise to pulmonary stenosis, sinosis at birth?
Type 1 cyst with normal great arteries and without pulmonary stenosis.
Without pulmonary stenosis, but in these cases, again, the blood flow is not markedly increased in these situations, in the normally related great vessels. So normally related great vessels with tricuspid atresia comes much lower down than a detransposed great vessels with tricuspid atresia. Correct?
Okay.
In those situations, the pulmonary vasculature is going to be flooded. Okay. When we are talking about detransposition, we are talking about not the pulmonary atresia or pulmonary stenosis. We are talking about those detransposition with large pulmonary blood flow. So it becomes the type 2C. Okay. What about L transposition with tricuspid atresia? How many types are there? Come on, you must tell me. Whose classification are we talking about?
Modified Kuhnhauer, sir.
Sorry?
Modified Kuhnhauer classification.
It is either modified, but the classification which is X-ray is Edwards classification. Edwards or Tandon's is different. Tandon's is totally different. Okay? Tandon's is basically on the basis of pulmonary blood flow. Okay? Whereas the Edwards classification is this one, 1, 2, and 3. And L transposition has got how many categories?
2, sir.
Yes, what are they?
Associated with subaortic and subpulmonary stenosis.
That's right, subaortic and subpulmonic stenosis. Those which are having subpulmonic stenosis is out of this particular entity, yes, which we are discussing as far as this case is concerned, right? So if you are talking about tricuspid atresia, you are talking about a DTGA with tricuspid atresia with a 2C, correct?
Awesome.
And if you are talking about L transposition, then which is the category you are talking about?
Type 3 with subpulmonic stenosis, sir.
No, not stenosis, pulmonary stenosis. We want large flow coming to the pulmonary. It is the category which is again 2B, I mean 3B, sorry. Which has 3B, got subaortic. You understood?
Okay, so subaortic stenosis. Okay.
Yeah, with the L transposed great vessels, right? So okay. We have talked about three entities. One is what? Second is what? DTGA VSD with no pulmonary stenosis. We are talking about tau sigmoid, which itself tells you that there is no pulmonary stenosis. We are talking about single ventricle with malposed great vessels with no pulmonary stenosis. Then we came to tricuspid atresia with either DTGA type 3, 2B, 2C, sorry, and type 3B.
Okay.
These are three. Which is the other which you have to enumerate in these situations with large flow, with cyanosis at birth?
With large flow. Truncus arteriosus, sir?
That's right, truncus arteriosus, no? Truncus arteriosus, by and large, is a situation where there is increased blood flow in almost 95 to 98% of the times.
Okay.
It is only in situations where there is about 5 to 3% of those patients who will come with stenosis of the pulmonary vasculature. Either where pulmonary vasculature, the stenosis is at the origin, or it is peripheral pulmonary vasculature. So most of the patients with truncus arteriosus will come with large flow. You must remember that, okay?
Okay.
And the differential will come on the other clinical findings, okay? So these things have to come. Then comes your lower down, your TAPVC will come. Any other?
Single atrium, common atrium.
That's right. Those patients who have got a common atrium or a common ventricle, the common ventricle we have already considered in the single ventricle settings. Yeah.
Right.
So common atrium Yes, can be considered. So TA PVC and common atrium will come little lower down. All right? Yeah. Okay. Now the other thing in the history which I think you have to consider when the child is born, besides the history of, you talked about increased sweating, okay, while feeding, okay. The other thing which is very important is the interrupted feeding. Do you understand what I mean to say? This is a very, very important history which you have to elaborate on, which you have to talk about, whether the patient during feeding had interrupted feeds or not. Okay, most of the patients who have got increased blood flow, okay, tend to have interrupted feeds. This is an important history finding which you have to think about, okay, or talk about positive or negative finding in the history. So interrupted feed is very important part of the cyanotic heart disease, okay, in general. Okay, so we now at the back of our mind have that these entities which are going to be thought of in this particular patient, okay. Now you come to the other part of the history, which is the syncope, correct, at the age of 8 years. Okay. Now you tell me, what are the congenital heart diseases first, which are associated with syncope, and those which are cyanotic heart disease, which are associated with syncope. No syncope, cyanosis with syncope, cyanosis with syncope.
Without cyanosis, syncope conditions are the congenital aortic stenosis, hypoplastic left heart.
Very good. No, hypoplastic left heart syndrome by and large do not present with syncope. Because if they have to survive, they have to have some communication between the pulmonary and the systemic circulation. Okay?
Okay.
It is not a presenting site. As you rightly said, this is the left ventricular outflow tract obstruction in an intact ventricular septum. Correct?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now, what are the other situations where you get so-called congenital heart disease and you present with syncope?
In cyanotic conditions, Eisenmenger feature.
No, I'm talking about acyanotic first. Acyanotic.
Acyanotic conditions, if AV septal defect is present, they may be associated with any congenital heart blocks that may lead to the syncope, sir.
Okay. Those patients who have got, say, AV canal type of a defect, and if they have got associated CHB, then may present with this, say, accepted. Yeah. What about other things? Any other?
Congenital complete
heart. Sorry? Congenital complete heart. Critical PS. Critical PS. That's right. When you talk about left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, which could be either, as we the other day when we said, either valvular aortic stenosis, which is the commonest, or subvalvar pulmonary aortic stenosis membrane. That is one thing with an intact interventing. The other thing is pulmonary stenosis, severe pulmonary stenosis with intact interventricular septum. Correct? I'm not talking about, yes. I'm just asking you a question of what are the categories in which you will get a syncope in a congenital heart disease. So aortic
stenosis with CHB, sir?
Yes, CCTGA with CHB, because that will come higher up than AV canal defect. So categorization is left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, right ventricular outflow obstruction in the phase of pulmonary stenosis. Both settings it is with intact ventricular septum. Correct?
Okay,
because if you have a VSD, then there is something different. The third is CTGA with complete heart block, or an AV canal defect with a complete heart block. These are situations where there is what you call as non-cyanotic heart disease presenting with syncope. Okay?
Okay.
Can you tell me what are the congenital heart diseases in order of frequency which present with AV blocks?
CCTGA, AVSDA,
First is corrected transposition. Yeah, very good. Second is
single ventricle physiology.
Yeah, single ventricle with usually with corrected transposition. When we talk about corrected transposition, it is with two ventricles or with single ventricles. So CTGA with two ventricles or CTGA with single ventricle accepted. Then AV canal defect. Yes, very good. AV canal defect. What other?
And rarely has been described with familial ASD.
Not so much, not accepted.
Then, okay. Epstein anomaly, sir.
Epstein's anomaly coming with complete heart block. Okay. This should come on this should come after the AV canal and the single ventricle CTG. And what about the last one?
Tricuspid atresia, sir.
They come in the single ventricle categories, most of them.
Congenital complete heart block, sir.
Congenital complete heart block in what settings usually?
Heterotaxis syndromes.
Particularly in children, this will come. That's right. Fantastic answer. Oh, those children of mothers who are having SLE, okay? These are the patients that the child may present with congenital complete heart block, okay? So these are basically five categories in which the child may present with complete heart block, okay? In the congenital setting. Okay, very good. Very good. Okay. So go ahead. So we talked about syncope. Now you talk about syncope in a cyanotic situation.
In cyanotic situation, top with critical PS and Eisenmenger physiology.
By and large, in a tetralogy of Fallot, when you have a VSD, whether you have a pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia, if the patient is surviving, that means he has got good collaterals coming, correct? In such situation, there is not likely to be hampering of the blood flow to the brain. So you cannot say, the only situation when you talk about whether it is a syncope or whether it is a
cyanotic spell.
That's right, cyanotic spell. So you have to be differentiating between whether he has syncope or whether it is a cyanotic spell. Correct? Now when you talk about a large flow situation, the question of cyanotic spell does not come in.
Yes.
Correct or not? Now we are talking about a syncope coming in a patient who has got a large flow. Large flow to the pulmonary vasculature. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
So what are the categorization of a syncope coming in a cyanotic heart disease?
Due to Eisenmenger ejection.
A very good answer. I think this is one thing which you have remembered. The history of syncope is one of the presenting features, can be one of the presenting features in patients who have got Eisenmengerization. This is one situation where you will get a history of syncope, that is Eisenmengerization. Okay? Very good. First, any other thing you can think of
syncope? Single atrium can measure with the heart.
Yes. In situations where there is AV canal defects, okay? With large flow and severe pulmonary hypertension setting in of pulmonary hypertension and presenting with complete heart block. These are the patients who usually would present with cyanosis and a complete heart block. Okay? The categorization again comes in situations where there is single ventricle with large flow or single ventricle with our third category of LTGA, DTGA, tricuspid atresia. You remember LTGA? Or increased blood flow, TGA, third type B. Type 3B. Those are the patients who are likely to present with AV blocks. Okay? In a cyanotic heart. Okay? Any post-operative you know of patients presenting with syncope?
Post-op top repair can present with the CHB, sir. And most commonly, yes. I do branch blocks, sir. But there will be chances of CHB also.
It is described, but it is not so common. What are the other situations post-operatively the patient may present with CHB, and you would require to put in a pacemaker in this patient? Surgical correction.
Sir, in the case of AVCD repair, AV canal defect repair, or
not so much. Not so much.
Perimembranous VSD repair.
No, not so much. Yes, you are right. It is VSD repair in a specific situation, wherein a patient who has got L transposition with ulnar stenosis, who present with cyanosis, and if you undertake a corrective surgery, and if you are trying to close the VSD, then in that case, the chances of developing complete heart block remains very high on card. Can somebody tell me why?
Because conduction system, conduction tissues are
yes.
Posterior and
anterior, right? You decide what it is, anterior or posterior. There are only two sides, no?
Yes, sir. In CCTG, it will be anterior, sir. DTG, it will be posterior or anterior.
Very important to remember that in corrected transposition, the His bundle travels along the anterior aspect of. So, in such situations, if you are trying to open up the pulmonary stenosis, or if you are trying to take the stitches onto the interventricular septum, you have to be very, very careful as to take the stitches from which side. So, that's why during congenital complete heart block corrections, you have to map out where the His bundle is and accordingly do the correction. So, if you are going to take a stitch, which side are you going to take a stitch? Normally, which side do you take if you have a VSD?
Right side, sir.
What do you mean right side? Now, in corrected transposition, when you answer this question, it is depending upon the morphological ventricle.
Okay.
So in corrected transposition, the His bundle runs along the superior and the left ventricular morphological left ventricular side. You understood what I'm trying to say? The His bundle runs along the superior aspect of the VSD and onto the left ventricular side. So you have to take cautiously the stitches that you take only chunk from the morphological right ventricular side. Okay? Morphological right ventricular side. And what is that right ventricular side morphological in corrected transposition? It is the systemic ventricle. Correct or not?
Also systemic ventricle.
Yeah, because it is a morphological right ventricle which is connected to the aorta in TCD. So this is an important point. Now when we come to this particular aspect, let me ask you, why do you get AV blocks commonly in CTG? Suresh?
I don't know correct answers.
You don't know? Anybody?
Because it has a tendency to go, as age increases, the conduction system has got a tendency to get fibrosed.
Yes. Why? You also are, normally also we get age. Does the His bundle fibrose? No. So there has
sir, been long course.
This thing.
Long course has got tendency to get fibrosed.
Okay. Now, you are right that in the corrected transposition, you have a long His bundle. Okay?
Yes.
Now, why does that happen? Why does that happen? It has got an embryological basis. Now, in a normal person, there are two AV nodes.
Atrial septum and ventricular septum are modeling.
No. It is basically two septums, two AV nodes which are there in the developmental plan. In the normal individual, what happens? Which one disintegrates normally?
which is located anteriorly is so normally posterior AV node persists.
That's right. It is two AV nodes, the anterior and the posterior AV node. Normally, the anterior AV node disintegrates and the posterior AV node makes the connection with the His bundle, which is coming from the ventricles. Okay? Now, in a situation of corrected transposition, because of the malalignment of the atrial septum and the ventricular septum, the posterior part of the interatrial septum and the interventricular septums are far away from each other. They come more closer to each other anteriorly. You understood what I'm trying to say? The plane of the ventricular septum and the atrial septum divert more posteriorly as compared to anteriorly. So the posterior the posterior AV node disintegrates in this situation, and it is the anterior AV node which tries to make a connection to the ventricular His bundle. Okay? And to make a connection, it has to have a very, very long His bundle formation to get it connected to the His bundle. You understood?
Okay, sir.
So it is basically on the basis of what happens embryologically. So you must remember, in embryologically, in corrected transposition, it is the anterior AV node which makes connection with the His bundle, not the posterior AV node, which normally connects, which is a short run for the AV node to have a connection with the ventricle. You got it? That is why they have a larger, longer His bundle, which has tendency to fibrose and give rise to AV blocks. And the AV blocks can be from intermittent AV blocks to fixed AV blocks to complete AV block. Okay? All right. So we come to the part where we spoke about the syncope. So now you correlate both of them as to a patient who is having a large flow, cyanotic heart disease, is coming with syncope. What I'm trying to tell you is you are analyzing each step of the history as to what are the likelihoods of this particular patient.
Then most common likelihood is tricuspid atresia with LT type 3B, sir.
Yes. Yes. Very good. What about the other? Why not single ventricle?
Single ventricle.
Yes, single ventricle should remain. And one of the things which we must keep in mind is the life expectancy with congenital cyanotic heart disease, particularly in large flow situations. The ones which are likely to persist and go for longer periods are single ventricles. Okay? Tricuspid atresia, very close to it. Then comes your DTGA, much lower. Then comes your truncus arteriosus, much lower down, because they develop pulmonary vasculature problems much earlier, failures and other things. Okay, so categorization wide, a patient who comes with large flow, you have to take into consideration a single ventricle or a DTG. Okay, so we are trying to cone down the thing as far as the history is concerned. Okay, first we categorize all those patients who had got cyanosis since birth with large flow because of the history which you said of increasing failure to thrive and increased sweating during feeding and interrupted feedings in these patients. So you have an idea that this is a large flow situation. You talked about the large flow situation. Then you had an added history of syncope, so we are trying to cone down that. Now you come to the third part of it where he underwent
At the age of 14 years,
sorry.
Yeah. Last month, 5 months back, he underwent surgery, sir.
Okay, so he underwent some surgery, and then now he has started presenting with symptoms of shortness of breath. So what is happening here? Can you tell me?
Actually, mother said it is a corrective surgery, sir. So no further surgery is required. In corrective surgery, most probably we can do for the tetralogy of the palate, which changed, but decreased flow condition, and other condition is transposition of great arteries, which we can't expect this long time of survival and delayed diagnosis. Third okay. one is TAPVC, sir. These three conditions have the complete corrected surgery, sir, without further requiring surgery.
Okay, so you are talking about a corrective surgery in this patient, in a patient who is supposed to be having a corrective surgery. Don't you think that a corrective surgery can be so-called corrective surgery?
In textbook, it is way, it is mostly it is a Fontan operation, sir. It is
yes.
a creative procedure, sir. It is.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it won't be a corrective surgery, mostly.
Yeah, it is not a corrective surgery per se, that you are not correcting the thing. The absolute corrective surgery will come in situation like tetralogy of Fallot or with DTGA or with VSD closures. Okay, correct? This will be or the other surgeries like closure of the PDA, closure of the ASDs, and these are corrective surgeries. But Fontan's is one surgery which is almost like a corrective surgery in a patient who has got tricuspid atresia or a single ventricle. Okay? All right? It is not a complete corrective surgery. It does not correct the anatomy. But this is the last surgery which you can give it to a patient who has got tricuspid atresia or a single ventricle.
Single ventricle.
Correct? Yeah? So you have to keep in mind either of the three. Now you talk about the corrective surgery in this patient who has got a large flow. Tell me, cyanotic heart flow disease which has got a large flow and you are talking about a corrective surgery.
Total anomalous pulmonary venous connection, sir. And transposition.
Very good. Okay. Either it is going to be a total anomalous pulmonary venous return, which is slightly higher up than a DTGA, because you are talking about a DTGA who has survived up to 14 years of age, and we are talking about a large flow. In such situation, usually the pulmonary vasculature changes have already occurred, and these patients do not become totally correctable. Okay. Unless and until the patient has got pulmonary stenosis, then you can think of doing a corrective surgery in a DTG. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
Most of the time, the corrective surgery in DTG is done before which age, before which age?
Mostly below six months of age.
By and large, yes, below 6 months, up to 1 year of age.
Up to 1 year of age.
After that, if changes... irreversible changes start occurring in the pulmonary vasculature, wherein it obviates the chances of doing a total correction, okay, the switch okay. in these patients, okay. So, you said TAPVC, agreed, DTGA, much lower down. Before that, anything else can you think of? You talked about some other condition, no, which with a large flow, but we are not taking into consideration the syncope truncus. Part of it. That's right, truncus arteriosus.
Answer, truncus arteriosus.
Yes, which type of truncus arteriosus has got a good prognosis and corrective thing? Okay, now you come back to... See, I'm trying to tell you as to how you come to a thing. Now, what is the classification of truncus?
In type 1, aorta and the large trunk arises and it divides into the aorta and pulmonary arteries.
So, see, main pulmonary artery arises from the trunk. That is one.
That is one.
Yes. Yes. Then,
type 2.
2 is what?
Left and right pulmonary artery arises posteriorly, and type 3
yes, both the right and the left pulmonary artery arise directly from the aorta, but closely onto the posterior aspect of the trunk.
Posterior.
Correct?
Posterior.
Yeah. The type 3 is what?
Both right and left pulmonary arteries arises from the aorta laterally to each other.
Right. They arise from the lateral aspect of the aorta or the truncus. Correct?
Yes.
And the fourth one is what?
Fourth one is, I didn't remember.
Sorry?
Hemitruncus or pseudotruncus? Pseudotruncus.
That's right. Seditruncus or the pseudotruncus. The type 4, wherein the pulmonary artery does not arise from the trunk. It arises from somewhere else. Okay?
Okay, sir.
All right? Now, out of these conditions, you must remember one thing, that pulmonary vasculature is flooded with blood in most of the cases of truncus arteriosus, as I told you. Right? Okay? From the beginning. Only in about 3% to 5% you will get pulmonary stenosis in these patients. If you have pulmonary stenosis in these patients, these are the patients who can survive and who can go on till second decade. Okay? Now, most of the time when you get the pulmonary stenosis, you get the pulmonary stenosis at the junction of the attachment of the pulmonary artery or arteries to the truncus. You understood?
Okay.
The stenosis occurs at the mouth of the pulmonary arterial segment. Okay.
Okay.
In these cases, so if you are talking about a rare entity of a truncus arteriosus with pulmonary stenosis, then this can be categorized and he can have a corrective surgery at this age. Okay.
Okay, sir.
All right. Now, what has happened after this particular surgery? After this surgery, he has had problem.
Shortness of breath.
Shortness of breath. And he has come to a stage where he has landed up with grade 4, isn't it? At rest also with an history of orthopnea. That means the patient is going into, initially was going into left ventricular, left-sided dysfunction. And now he is coming with congestive cardiac failure.
Okay.
Correct? Correct or not? I am just elaborating on the history which you are showing.
Mostly, but it is delivered after the intercostal tube insertions.
So you are talking about the patient had an intercostal drain which was there, which happened. Okay. So he started with having the surgical. So one of the situations you are talking about, that the patient had got something to do with the intercostal drainage which has been removed, and is he feeling better after that?
He feeling better after that, sir.
Okay. So what is the likelihood there?
I'm suspecting any surgical complication that leads to the pulmonary effusion, something like that.
Are you talking about pulmonary effusion collection in the pulmonary space, the pleural space, or you're talking about what other possibility is there?
Other possibilities are left ventricular failure that leads to the right ventricular failure that leads to the pulmonary effusion that causes the symptoms, but there is no
right ventricular does not give rise to problems to the pulmonary vasculature, Suresh. They will give you congestive failure problems. Okay, if at all you get pulmonary, I mean pleural effusion, it is either secondary to the severe left ventricular dysfunction. Okay, left ventricular failure. Yeah. Added on to that, if you have congestive cardiac failure, then you may get pleural effusion. Any other possibilities you are thinking of that you put in the drain and you have feeling better? Is there a possibility of a pneumothorax in this patient?
But delayed presentation after 2 months, the pneumothorax, they will present mostly immediately after surgery, sir.
That's right. Very good point, that usually if you have a pneumothorax, it is likely to be presenting much earlier. So here we are having a patient who has developed a pleural. We conclude, as far as the history is concerned, that the patient has got some fluid collection in the pleural space which has been drained out on the left side, correct? Now we don't know whether it is related to the surgical complication or whether it is related to infection. Okay?
Okay.
So we lead to that because there is nothing we can correlate as far as the surgical thing is concerned, because the patient itself was presenting with a large flow situation. Okay, wherein if the patient were to go in failure, he would have manifested earlier before the surgical thing, isn't it? You understand what I'm trying to say? That these are signs which you are talking about right now, post-surgical, are signs of left ventricular failure, if at all.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, why should the patient who has been corrected for a large flow situation try to go again into left ventricular failure? It is very unlikely, isn't it? So it is. This does not correlate well with the surgical problem related to the intracardiac repair. This is something out of the intracardiac repair which has occurred. Maybe some pleural effusion, maybe because of some complication related to the surgery or infection. Okay?
Okay.
So now we have come to a diagnosis as far as the history is concerned, a large flow situation of a patient who has got history of failure to thrive at birth, presenting at 14 years of age, has undergone corrective surgery, has landed up with shortness of breath, a tube has been put in, he has come out of it better. Okay?
Yes.
So now go on to the specific examinations.
In examination, patient is conscious and coherent, oriented to time, place, person.
Only positive findings, Suresh.
Positive findings. Pulse rate is 90 per minute, regular, decreased volume with no radial and radiofemoral delay. All peripheral pulses are well filled. Blood pressure is 80/60 mmHg in the right upper limb and 90/60 mmHg in the right lower limb. Respiratory rate is 26 per minute, regular, abdominal, thoracic. Pallor is ephemeral, pallor is present. Grade 3 pan-digital clubbing is present. There is no saturation, no uterus, no lymphadenopathy, no pedal edema. Saturation of upper limb is 97% and lower limb is 98%. BMI of 14 kg per meter square. No signs of no cleft palate, no syndactyly, no polydactyly, no signs of infective endocarditis. Oral cavity examination is normal, spine examination is normal. There is a right-sided intercostal tube draining.
Okay.
KVP is 4 cm above the sternal angle at 45 degrees of angle with a prominent EA wave and no Kussmaul sign is present.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And inspection, chest is bilateral symmetrical.
No. First, you are coming to the cardiovascular system. Wait there.
Yes. Okay.
Now, couple of things. Now, in post-operative situation, two things you have to mention. Now, in this case, it may not be correlant as far as this particular patient because he is at rest and with the intercostal tube. Now, in such patients who has undergone a surgery for a congenital cyanotic heart disease, whatever surgery is done or otherwise also, if the patient is not having cyanosis at rest, then you have to speak about patient giving him some exercise and seeing whether the cyanosis becomes manifest or not. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Because this is very important when you talk about situations where there is a pink fellows, as we call it.
Okay,
cyanosis which is not evident at rest. But you make the patient exercise a little bit, go around the room or go around the hall and come back and you analyze his PCI saturation, okay, with the pulse oximeter, whether the patient is manifesting with cyanosis or not. This could be important even in patient who are post-operative status but who are mobile. In your patient, it is not possible, correct? Because the patient has got an intercostal. But this is one thing you must keep it in mind. The second thing we are talking about this patient, you find that the pulse pressure is practically low to not low. It is 80/60 or it is low. Correct or not?
It is low volume, sir.
Low volume pulse and all the peripheral pulsations are very well felt. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So we are not talking about anything other than a corrective surgery, intracardiac corrective surgery, which could have been done in this patient. Okay? This tells you about that. All right? Now you go to the specific examination. Tell us something about the JVP.
Yes. JVP 4 centimeter above the sternal angle, sir, slightly increased with the prominent A wave, sir.
So the JVP is raised or JVP is not raised?
4 centimeter at 45 degrees in 45 degrees angle, sir. Increased, sir.
It is increased.
Yes, sir.
Now how will you say that the JVP is raised in a child as against an adult? You understand my question?
Yes, yes.
Because when you talk about the JVP, it is ultimately the column of blood which is supported by the right atrium in an angle of 45 degrees. Correct or not? Why 45 degrees?
Yes.
Why 45 degrees is taken as the point when you take the JVP into consideration whether it is raised or not?
The right atrial midpoint position is about 5 centimeters depth.
Okay.
JVP,
you are right. This we are talking about in an adult patient.
Okay, sir.
This 5 centimeters criteria is for an adult, that the midpoint of the right atrium to the angle of the meribrium sternum would be approximately about 5 centimeters. Okay. From the meribrium sternum at 45 degrees, the upper part of the clavicle is approximately about 4 centimeters.
Okay.
So total column of blood from the right atrium, midpoint of the right atrium to the upper limit of upper level of the clavicle would be approximately 9 centimeters. Correct?
Okay, sir.
This is the normal JVP. Correct or not?
Okay, sir.
So if the column of the blood gets evidently seen above the level of the clavicle, then you know that the JVP is raised. In an adult, I am talking about. In an adult, again I am emphasizing. Okay? And then once the JVP is raised, you can talk about the particular waves which you can see in the JVP. Either the A wave, the V wave, the CV wave, whatever you want to talk about, as well as the troughs. For that, the JVP has to be evident above the level of the clavicle. Now, in situations where your JVP is not seen above the level of the clavicle, then what do? You make the patient lie down a little more, maybe 30 degrees or flat, and then see what are the waves seen in the JVP. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what is the criteria which you take into consideration in a child?
Liver pulsations, sir?
No. The liver pulsations will be telling you about the increase in this venous pressure. Correct or not? Back pressure sent about by the right side. So, is the criteria remain the same or not as far as the JVP is concerned?
In children, because of the short neck, it may be difficult to observe the jugular venous pressure, sir. Then we may look for the dorsum
basically,
of the
hand. Basically, in children, the correlation between the height of the JVP and the pressure, actual pressure in the right side of the heart, cannot be correlated well. You understand? Because these people have got a short neck, most of them. And the distance between the mid-right atrium to the clavicle is likely to be significantly variable. Okay? So in children, you have to specifically mention as what is going to be the height of the JVP in centimeters.
Okay.
Okay? So you are going to make the child lie in 45 degrees and then tell me what is the height of the JVP, okay, at 45 degrees. Now you said it is 4 centimeters, correct?
4 centimeters.
4 centimeters in a child of 14 years of age who's almost coming to the adolescent age. So a 4 centimeter suggests that there is a slight increase in the JVP, correct?
Yes.
You understood now what I am trying to harp. But if it is a smaller child, the correlation between the JVP and the actual pressure is very, very difficult to say. You can say that in a child, it is very difficult to say if the JVP, unless the JVP is markedly raised in a child, going up to the angle of the jaw, then you can say that, yes, the JVP is raised in this child. But otherwise, in a normal child, if you are going to talk about the JVP, a normal small, say maybe 5 years or 6 years, you will not be able to correlate as to what is the height of the JVP. In these patients, you may say that the JVP is this much centimeters from above the midclavicular, from the manubrium sternal angle. You understand?
Yes.
So this is the important thing. Now, if the examiner keeps on harping, is the JVP raised or not? You can say, depending upon the, you have to be a little smart as far as answering this is. Depending upon what are the waves which are seen on the JVP, you can say, yes, it may be mildly raised or not. If it is obviously raised up to the level of the angle of the jaw, then it is definitely raised in a child. You understand? At 45 degrees.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay,
so now you said that the JVP is about 4 centimeters. That means it is slightly raised because it is obviously seen above the level of the clavicle and it has got a prominent A wave, correct?
Yes.
Okay?
Okay, sir.
Now, Suresh, you tell me which are the situations in which, when do you say that the JVP has got a giant A wave and when do you say the patient has got a cannon wave?
Giant A wave is seen in the cyanotic heart disease, like tricuspid at
least. No, I'm not talking about cyanotic heart disease. I'm just asking you a question in general. When do you say the patient has got a giant A wave?
If your atrium is contracting against the narrow tricuspid orifice, that leads to the increased A wave.
I'm not asking you about the causes of giant A wave. I'm asking you, when do you categorize the patient is having a giant A wave against the patient who has got a cannon A wave?
Cannon wave is in CHB, sir, atrial ventricular dissociation.
I'm not asking you about the causes of the. I'm asking
when
you.
Cannon A wave is a systolic event. Giant A wave is pre-systolic.
No. On the jugular venous pressure, are there certain criteria which tell you that this is a giant A wave and this is a cannon A wave? You understood my question? What I'm trying to
cannon
say?
Cannon wave. So during the systolic period, if there is a A wave, that is the cannon wave, sir. Large A wave during the systolic period coincide with the S1.
Sir, okay. Okay, let me tell you what it is.
Sir, giant wave.
Yeah.
Sir, we say giant wave.
More than 4.5 centimeter and 45 or twice the mean JVP, sir. That is giant A wave. And it is normal in normal sinus rhythm. But cannon A wave is present in heart failure and heart blocks. So cannon.
Okay. You are very close to it. When you talk about a giant A wave, usually the A wave goes right up to the angle of the jaw, okay? The categorization of a cannon wave is that it is also prominent wave which is going right up to the angle of the jaw, but it is the timing which differentiate both of them. In a giant A wave, it is a pre-systolic event. Whereas in a cannon wave, as you rightly said, it is a systolic event. You understood?
Okay.
You understand, no? So it is on the basis of the timings. For that, you will have to palpate the carotid and say whether the patient is having a giant A wave or a Canon A wave. Now you tell me, Suresh, what are the causes of giant A wave? 1, 2, 3, 4, fast.
Tricuspid pulmonary hypertension with RVH and tricuspid stenosis. And
when you talk about pulmonary stenosis, you have to be categorically mentioning what type of pulmonary stenosis. If you have a VSD with a pulmonary stenosis, you will not get an A wave.
Tricuspid stenosis.
First is, yes, of course, a tricuspid stenosis, severe tricuspid stenosis. Yeah. The second is what?
Eisenmenger, ASD, atrial septal defect.
No. So what are the situations in which you will get a giant A wave? One is your tricuspid stenosis, agreed. What about the other thing? You said pulmonary stenosis or right ventricular hypertrophy, no? Correct. If you talk about pulmonary stenosis, yes, it is one of the causes, but you have to specify that it is pulmonary stenosis with intact interventricular septum. You understand? If you have a VSD with pulmonary stenosis, you will not get a giant A.
Okay.
Yeah. Then any other cause of severe pulmonary hypertension, you can get a very prominent to giant A wave. What are those situations?
Idiopathic PH.
That's right. Primary pulmonary hypertension. Yeah.
Then as a reverse Burgheim effect in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Okay. That is usually a prominent A wave, not a giant A wave.
Which type of
I gave you a clue, which type of Eisengerization you would get a prominent or
ASD Eisenmenger?
By and large, no, you're not with ASD. It is usually with PDA.
PDA.
Yeah. PDA with Eisenmengerization, wherein there is no VSD, no ASD, you will see a prominent A wave, or maybe sometimes very uncommonly you will see a giant A wave. But usually in Eisenmengerization with atrial septal defect, you can see an A wave. But in a patient who has got Eisenmengerized syndrome, that is VSD with pulmonary hypertension, we will never get an A wave in this situation unless there are signs of left ventricular dysfunction occurring. Okay? Because both the ventricles are acting as single ventricle now in that situation. Okay. Now come to what are the causes of Canon waves?
Regular Canon waves or irregular Canon waves? Regular Canon waves are seen in ventricular tachycardia.
Regular? Yeah. Okay.
Irregular Canon waves are seen in the AV dissociation, like a complete heart block.
In what type of ventricular tachycardia you will get a A waves coming regularly?
V2A retrograde conduction, sir.
See, basically in patients who have got an wailing AV block or a ventricular tachycardia, slow ventricular tachycardia, you will tend to get an intermittent Canon waves. When the atrium, right atrium, contracts against a closed AV valve, okay? Alright, not in ventricular tachycardia. Ventricular specific ventricular tachycardia with retrograde conduction, a slow ventricular tachycardia with a retrograde conduction to the atria is one situation where you may get a regular Canon wave. But by and large, in a ventricular tachycardia, a slow ventricular tachycardia, you might get irregular Canon waves as you get it in the AV blocks. Okay? Now, regular Canon wave? What are the situations in which you will get a regular Canon wave? That means the atria is contracting against a closed AV valve, no?
regularly. At what is that?
Junctional tachycardia, sir.
That's right, junctional tachycardia. Very good. In situations where there is junctional tachycardia, you will see a regular cannon beam. All the other situations, you will get an irregular cannon beam. Okay? All right? Okay. Now, in a patient who has got a... Okay, we'll go again. We'll go ahead. We'll succumb to JVP sometime later. Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead with the physical examination of the cardiovascular system.
And inspection, chest in bilaterally symmetrical, no precardial bulge is present, apex seen at fifth intercostal space, lateral to the midclavicular line, midline scar are present, which is of 21 cm, without any induration or discharge, no dilated veins or sinuses, no visible epigastric pulsations are present. And palpation, inspectory findings are confirmed, apex felt at 5th intercostal space, 2 cm lateral to the midclavicular line, diffuse type with lateral retraction, which is of RV type of apex.
Okay.
Palpable P2 is present in the left second intercostal space, and epigastric pulsations are felt with the tip of the finger, parasternal heave of grade 2/3 is present.
Okay.
And percussion, left heart border corresponds to the apex and right heart border corresponds to right border of the sternum. Left second intercostal space is dull and percussion. Liver dullness felt at fifth intercostal space in midclavicular line. And the tympanic note of the stomach is present. And auscultation, S1 is normal, S2 is wide variable speed with loud P2 component, and no ejection click, no S3 and no S4 is present.
S2 is what? Sorry, say that again. S2?
Wide variable speed, sir.
Okay, wide, okay. What do you mean by wide variable? Is it moving with phases of respiration or whether it is not moving with phases? You have to be very, very, very categorizing as far as this statement is concerned.
It is moving
with the phases of the respiration. It is widely split. First thing, it is moving or it is not moving. Second, it what phases of respiration it is moving.
Okay, sir. Wide variable split during the inspiration phase, sir.
Okay, so it is normally splitting, in other words.
Normal splitting, sir.
With P2 component?
Loud P2 component, sir.
Yeah, okay, loud, okay. So when you talk about, see, most of the emphasis in congenital heart disease goes in the auscultation of the second heart. So a couple of things you must remember at the back of mind when you do an examination of a patient of a congenital heart disease. First is the peripheral pulsations. Okay?
Okay.
The second thing is the pulse pressure in the patient. Okay?
Okay.
The third is the JVP.
Okay.
The fourth is the apex beat, in correlation with the midclavicular line. I am talking about congenital heart disease, okay? These are the points wherein you have to spend little more time. And the lastly and the most important thing is maximum time has to be spent on the second heart sound.
Okay.
Alright? So whenever you have a congenital heart disease, these are the things which you have to spend some more time. And particularly so on the second heart sound, because the entire diagnosis of a congenital heart disease depends practically on the second heart sound. Okay?
Okay.
So when you talk about the second heart sound, all parameters have to be given. First thing is the splitting of the second heart sound. Okay? The second thing is variability with phases of respiration. And the third one is the intensity of the second heart sound, whether it is the A2 or the P2, which is accentuated, or whether it is normal or softer. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. So you have a widely splitting second heart sound with prominent P2 component moving normally with phases of respiration, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
And no ejection click is with no ejection click, no S3 and no S4 is present, sir. Pan systolic murmur of grade 3/6 to our left lower sternal border, which is of soft blowing in nature, in supine position with diaphragm of the stethoscope, which is increasing during inspiration and leg raising, is present, sir.
Okay. Grade?
Grade 3/6, sir.
Okay. Grade 3/6. Pan-diastolic, pan-systolic murmur.
Pan-systolic murmur, sir.
Okay, right. Then?
And then, and respiratory system examination?
No. Okay. Now, again, you know, when you're correlating your findings, you have to be a little smart as far as the findings is concerned. Now, why I'm telling you is you are talking about a situation wherein the patient has got pulmonary hypertension, correct? P2 component is higher, right? The patient has got a tricuspid regurgitation murmur. Okay. Now, in such situation, and the patient GVP is mildly raised, correct?
Yes, sir.
So, the patient has got some signs of congestive right-sided failure. Okay?
Yes, sir.
In this situation, you have to elaborate and talk about the extra sound. What is the extra sound you are expecting, or which you have to say that it is present or not?
No murmur seen on the back side.
No, I'm talking about the extra sound here. The RVS3, no?
RVS3, okay.
Correct or not?
Sir, important. This is important.
This is very important you have to talk about.
Okay.
About the RVS3 point of here. If you are not able to auscultate that thing, that means something is wrong with you. You have to look out for that. Because the patient has got pulmonary hypertension, he's got significant TR, his JVP is raised, and the patient is showing some signs of right ventricular dysfunction. Okay?
Okay, so RVS3.
So you have to talk about RVS3. And you can say that, yes, you have to be smart enough to say, yeah, I feel that there is an RVS3. Nobody is going to challenge that.
Okay, sir.
Okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, go on.
And respiratory system examination, there is present on the right axillary line, sir. And there is an intercostal tube drainage in C2, sir.
Okay.
During the examination period.
Yeah.
And other system examination.
Anything relevant in the other examination?
No.
When you talk about the negative point, what are you going to talk about the negative point?
In other systems, sir?
Yes.
In CNS, I have to look for the focal neurological...
Not CNS. I'm talking about specific. You have to talk about the liver, no?
Liver, sir. There is no liver.
Why do you... Yeah, you want to see about what is happening to the size of the liver, whether it is enlarged or not, and you have to talk about whether there is pulsations or not. Because here you are trying to correlate your right ventricular dysfunctions findings.
Okay. Okay,
so these are important negative features you must keep in mind, that when I am going to go having these particular things, I am going to look for 1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, sir.
Okay. These are important positive or negative findings which you are going to elaborate during your history. Okay?
Okay,
and findings. All right. So now, Suresh, tell us. Patient has undergone surgery, corrective surgery, so-called. And the patient has come with these particular findings, correct or not?
Yes, sir.
In the beginning, we talked about congenital cyanotic heart disease of patient who has got either a DTGA, okay, type 2C. We talked about and we talked about AV canal defects and TAPVC. Correct? Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, out of these situations, on the clinical findings, you start ruling out one after the other.
Okay.
DTJ is completely out?
Yes, DTJ is completely out. I am suspecting it is completely out because it is present with severe cyanosis in the early childhood. Sir. There will be no...
Forget about that. I am now you are correlating with your findings now. So DTJ is completely out because you are getting what?
Peristinal heave, sir.
No, peristinal heave would be there with DTG also. You're talking because, about, see, yes, the second heart sound is important, no?
Second heart sound is wide fixed, sir.
It is very well heard as far as you are concerned. I have not auscultated the patient. It is very well heard. You are hearing beautifully the P2 component as well as the A2 component. The P2C is accentuated. So, in situation where there is DTGA, usually it is a single second heart sound, correct?
Single second, yes, sir.
Correct or not?
Yes, sir, correct.
And here you are getting a wide split second heart sound with a P2 component which is accentuated, moving very well with respiration. So your DTGA is out, correct?
Yes, sir.
The second entity about a single ventricle with L transpose or D transpose again is out because on the basis of the second heart sound, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah? The third possibility of a truncus arteriosus again is totally out of this contention.
Yes, sir. That is also single S2.
Yeah. When you would expect to find a loud single second heart sound, usually it is the A2 component. Sometimes clinically they have described a splitting of the second heart sound because of the different leaflets banging in differently. But that is not for our contention. For us, truncus arteriosus is a single loud second heart sound, the truncal sound, correct? So these are ruled out, correct or not?
Yes, sir.
So we have come to a closer differential diagnosis now as far as this thing with a large flow. So what are they? AV canal defect with a large flow setting, and we talked about a TAPVC. And single atrium. Correct or not? The AV canal type of defects.
Okay. Yeah.
So, which one of them fits in here?
TAPVC and single atrium, I am not able to differentiate.
Why TAPVC you are not able to differentiate? Whether it is TAPVC or whether it is a AV canal type of a defect. Okay? Are you able to differentiate between them?
If there is AV canal defect, single S2, that may associate with the, if there is AST, there may be associated with the Y variable split.
Sorry, I can't hear you. Sorry?
Single atrium is also associated with the wide variable split, sir. TAPVC is also associated with the wide variable split.
By and large, usually in a situation where there is pulmonary hypertension right from birth, okay, where there is a large flow, the P2 component tends to remain shorter. I mean, the S2 component tends to remain closely split, okay, because of the pulmonary vascular changes which occur with the pulmonary component being higher because of the increase in the pulmonary pressure, okay? Now, most of the time in patients who have got pulmonary hypertension in a setting of congenital heart disease, the splitting of the second heart sound is usually closely split second heart sound. They may or may not vary with the various phases of respiration depending upon the RV function. If you find that there is RV dysfunction in a patient who has got congenital heart disease, then the splitting of the second heart sound depends upon the function of the right ventricle. If you find the right ventricle is failing significantly or have showing signs of dysfunction in a patient who has got pulmonary hypertension, so these are the situations where the P2 component will be widely split. Correct? Pulmonary ejection period from the right ventricle is delayed significantly if the patient has got RV dysfunction. Okay?
in situation where there is pulmonary hypertension right from birth, the P2 component splitting will depend upon the RV function. Normally, it is closely split. Varying of the respiration or not will depend upon the interatrial communication. If the interatrial communication is intact, then most of the time the splitting will be normal with the various phases of respiration. Okay?
Okay.
Now, what happens in a patient who has got TA-PVC? Okay? In these patients, this is the only situation wherein the P2 will tend to be widely split with a patient who has got cyanosis. Correct?
Okay.
And these patients usually have a fixed and a wide splitting of the second heart zone because of the interatrial septum and the TA-PVC. So this is one situation of cyanosis wherein the second heart sound is going to be widely split and it is fixed. Correct?
Okay. Okay.
So coming to this particular patient, what is the likelihood of this patient having undergone corrective surgery for a TA-PVC? Or a corrective surgery for an AV canal defect or a common atrium, whatever it may be. I am talking about generalizing the categorization of a common AV canal. I mean, an AV canal defect with surgical correction.
But TA-PVC, mostly we do pulmonary venous reconnection, sir, with closure of the interatrial septal defect, sir.
Yeah, particularly if you have a common pulmonary venous chamber atrium, then cutting the blood becomes very easy. Okay? Okay? So, in patients who have got, now in your situation, you have got a patient who has got some amount of RV dysfunction. Correct?
Yes. Yes.
Because of the TR and because of the raised JVP.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
And then you can explain that the RV, the second heart sound is widely split. Okay?
Yes. Yes.
Now, in a TA-PVC, usually the correction is a intracardiac correction, but you do not do anything to the ventricular things, you know, ventricular anatomy. Correct or not?
Yes.
It is usually related to the correction as far as the interatrial septum anatomy is concerned. Correct?
Yes. Yes.
Whereas in AV canal defect, it is a different ball game altogether. Now, most of the time when you have an AV canal type of a defect, common atrium or an AV canal type of a VSD, what is the common associated findings with them?
There is a cleft mitral wall compression.
Yes, yes. Absolutely right. So, in this situation, these patients by and large tend to have a cleft in the anterior mitral leaflet. Okay.
Yes.
Now, if you are going to do a total correction in these patients, you have to not only do the correction of the ASD as well as VSD, but then you have to take care of the cleft also.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
And this becomes a little complex surgery as far as the patient is concerned. When you grade a TA-PVC which has got a supracardiac variety of TA-PVC, the surgery is relatively simple and it's a total correction.
Okay, sir.
When you have an AV canal type of a defect, or an AV canal means I am categorizing ball, common atrium or an AV canal type of a defect, this becomes a slightly complex surgery because you have to close the ASD as VSD and also take care of the cleft in the mitral wall leaflet. Okay?
Okay.
So whenever you have a little complex type of a surgical entity which you have undertaken in a particular patient, the outcome of the surgery is going to reflect. Correct?
Okay. Okay.
Any situation where you are going to have a situation where you have to handle the ventricular septums or the ventricular part are the patients who are likely to have post-operative problems.
Okay.
Okay. In general.
Okay.
So when we talk about this particular patient, T
TAPVC, although is a consideration, for me it comes a little lower down.
Okay.
I would consider of a patient who has got an AV canal tract of a defect, who had pulmonary hypertension, who has undergone surgery, and now he has undergone the corrective surgery, but has landed up with a signs of pulmonary hypertension persisting with tricuspid regurgitation and some amount of congestive cardiac failure. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now the other part is whether this regurgitation is a complication of the surgery or whether it is a natural course of events which is occurring. We don't know at the present moment. And when you talk about what is happening to the natural course of the events, what are you talking about? That in patients who have got a large flow to the pulmonary vasculature, okay, they start getting obliterated. Do a corrective surgery in patients. 1 minute, I'm having an important call. 1 minute. Hello?
Yes.
Hello? Yeah, I've come back?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, in patients who have got a pulmonary, increased pulmonary vasculature right from beginning, okay, from birth,
okay.
And if you do a corrective surgery on them, then there is a possibility that over the course of time, once you have done a corrective surgery, there is progressive pulmonary hypertension which continues to happen.
Okay.
That means although you have done the corrective surgery, the pulmonary vasculature will not involute because the large flow has been there for such a significant length of time, almost 14 years in this patient. So he might have started having obliterative pulmonary vascular changes already in this patient. Okay. And once you correct the defect, the pulmonary vasculature changes continue to go ahead. And the patient may start developing pulmonary hypertensive changes over the course of time. We don't know what is happening in this patient, whether the patient has gone into right ventricular dysfunction with TR because of the surgical problem and the pulmonary hypertension is still persisting because of the non-involution of the pulmonary vasculature. It is very, very difficult to say at this point. So what is going to be your final diagnosis in this patient? Give me the final diagnosis 1, 2, 3, 4.
Congenital cyanotic heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, most probably with admixture lesion, differential diagnosis of single atrium, common atrium, and second diagnosis is total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. Post-operative status with severe pulmonary artery hypertension and severe functional tricuspid regurgitation, with features of CCF, without features of infective endocarditis, in normal sinus rhythm, in NVHA functional class 2 at present.
Okay, and also his post-operative problem, that he probably he has a pleural problem, you know,
yes,
where the pleural effusion which has been drained, that also has to be mentioned.
Okay, sir.
Okay?
Okay, sir.
All right. So we have gone down to this particular thing. Now show us what is the ECG.
Sir, presently I didn't have, sir. I am expecting the right ventricular hypertrophy with prominent R wave in the V1 and P2, sir.
Naturally, you are going to find, because you are finding signs of pulmonary hypertension with right. Isn't it? You have got a parasternal heave. And you got features of tricuspid regurgitation. Correct or not?
Yes.
So in this case, what you should have elaborated is the right ventricular S3. You should have talked about the the liver pulsations. Okay. We know that you have spoken about the JVP is also high. All right.
Okay.
So okay. You don't have the ECG?
Presently, I don't have the ECG.
Okay. Okay. You know what was the ECG like? You would expect...
During the right axis deviation, sir, with right ventricular hypertrophy, sir.
Now the other thing which I wanted you to elaborate as far as the ECG is concerned is besides the right ventricular hypertrophy, whether the patient has got a right bundle branch block or not.
There is a right bundle branch block,
you know. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
And if you have a right bundle branch block in this setting, what does it tell you?
There is importance of interatrial septal defects, sir.
Yes, one is whether the patient had an interatrial septal defect or not. And particularly so if the patient has got a right bundle branch block with a left axis deviation. You are considering one possibility of a common atrium. Now, whenever you have an AV canal type of defect, the axis is always leftward. Okay, August. Always leftward.
August.
All the August. Other ASDs, you will get a right axis.
Yes.
Okay, so you yes. have a right bundle branch block, which tells you that it could be an ASD, or in yes. other words, it tells you that it is a volume overloaded right ventricle because of the TR.
Okay.
We are not able to differentiate, but only thing which you are able to differentiate here is the axis, which will help you to tell you what it is, and the second is the right ventricular hypertrophy in the presence of a right bundle branch block. Okay?
Yes.
Also, in this situation, it is important to know what is the strain pattern as far as the right ventricle is concerned.
Okay.
Because, why it is important is because this is a patient in a post-operative status.
Okay.
So, you have to talk about the right ventricular T waves basically, whether they are deeply inverted or not. I don't know what they were.
Okay.
Most of the situation when they are volume overload and in the post-operative status, particularly if you see it in patients who have undergone surgery for tetralogy of Fallot, you will find that these patients have got right bundle branch block, signifying that there is volume overload because of the PR. The second thing is there are deep inverted T waves in the chest leads, okay, which signifies that there is a volume overload as well as subendocardial ischemia of the right ventricle, which occurs, particularly so in the post-operative period, okay?
Okay, sir.
So these things you have to keep in mind when you analyze the ECG. X-ray?
X-ray, I won't.
You don't have? Did you see the?
Presently they did not have X-ray, sir. I have not seen.
No, but did you see the X-ray? No.
Yes, sir. There is a. I have remembered that there is a confluence towards the right side of the upper right up. Right upper cardiac border, sir. There is a mass-like appearance.
Okay. That means there is a shadow.
A shadow, sir.
Above the right atrium at the junction of the RA and the SVC, correct?
SVC, sir.
Yeah. So what is the likelihood there?
That is the suspected as the confluence of the total anomalous coronary venous connection that leads to that shadow, sir.
Yeah, which is now diverted to the right atrium. Okay.
Yes.
Now,
yes.
When you have a confluence of a common chamber,
yes.
which you want to divert to the right atrium, okay?
Yes.
How do you do that? Operative? Do you have any idea how the
actually
supracardiac variety of TAPVC?
Yes, sir. It is a supracardiac TAPVC opening into the SVC, sir, superior vena cava, sir. They have made a baffle from the SVC opening to the interatrial septal defect, sir, to the left ventricles.
To the left ventricle?
Left atrium. To the left atrium via interatrial septal defect. They made a baffle, sir.
Okay, very good. So, this is one of the possibilities in which there are two or three types in which they tackle. If it is coming in the supracardiac variety of TAPVC, then, as you rightly said, they can do the baffle, which covers
the opening of the common chamber, okay, across the superior vena cava, through the interatrial septum into the left atrium. Okay. Now, if you have a very good common chamber which is sitting right behind the atrium, okay, right atrium here, you can put a baffle right from this common chamber to the left atrium. Okay. And you have to close the connection, the supracardiac connections. Ligate the supracardiac connection. You understand both at the SVC as well as the... Now, when you form the figure of 8 in a supracardiac variety, what are the segments of the supracardiac variety TAPVC?
In the left upper part, there is the vertical vein, sir.
Yes, vertical vein, embryologically, what is it?
Embryologically, left persistent superior vena cava, sir.
That's right, right superior pulmonary vena cava. Okay, then?
Right sided upper body is formed by the right superior vena cava, sir.
Right superior vena cava is okay. It is normally also there. What is the communicator? The left vertical vein, and then what is the intermittent part which forms the upper part of the figure of 8?
That is horizontal.
Yes, what is that? Anybody? Sorry? That's right. Denominate vein.
Okay, denominate vein.
So it is the persistent left superior vena cava, which is the vertical vein, which is coming from the common chamber, and it is communicated by the denominate vein into the superior vena cava. You understood?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, most of the time when you do the intracardiac baffle, baffle from the superior vena cava to the left atrium, you will see what is seen as the shadow which is hovering around the superior vena cava. Okay? Because that figure of 8 and everything still persists in these patients.
Okay?
It still persists because this anatomy you have not disturbed.
Okay.
You understand, or correct or not? You have not disturbed this particular anatomy of the common chamber with the vertical vein, with the innominate vein joining the SVC and the baffle. So you will continue to see the baffle or the figure of 8 or the snowman sign in a patient who has gone repair for the total anomalous pulmonary venous return, which is done by a baffle. Okay. That is why I was saying that this is important to see the CDV X-ray. One minute. I'll just come.
Okay.
Yes, sir. We are there, sir.
We see, if you have done this type of a correction, most of the time you will continue to see the classical picture of a TAPVC. Okay. That is the figure of 8. All right. Hello.
Yes, sir.
So, what is the finding on the echocardiography?
In echocardiography, there will be. We have to look for the pulmonary venous connections, sir. Whether they are opening into the right, left vein, left atrium or not, specifically.
Why specifically? You have to look for it.
Yes.
So, which is the view from which you look for?
In an apical four chamber view, we can see the...
No. In the apical four chamber, usually you see only two of them.
The
upper left pulmonary vein and the lower left pulmonary vein. But the right-sided pulmonary vein will not be seen. All the subcostal view. Okay?
Okay,
subcostal view. It is very, very important to see the pulmonary venous connection. It is basically from the subcostal vein that you determine whether the pulmonary veins are draining or not. Okay? If you find that the pulmonary veins are not draining, then it strengthens your possibility of a TAPVC going in. Any other view?
to look for the obstruction of the venous.
Yeah, obstruction, that is very rare, but you can see the obstruction at the site of the junction of the vertical, I mean the innominate vein with the SVC. This is the sign at which usually you get the obstruction most of the time. The other thing, which other important view in TAPVC supracardiac variety, is to take the suprasternal view. Okay?
Okay.
The suprasternal view, you'll be able to trace the connections right from the common chamber coming by the vertical, left vertical vein to the innominate vein and going to the superior vena cava. So you'll see a large flow coming from these segments to the pulmonary, to the SVC. You understood?
Okay.
This can be seen very well in the color Doppler venous flow coming. Alright?
Okay.
And then in this case, you will be able to see the baffle. Now, the important part here is to see whether there is any obstruction at the level of the baffle.
Okay.
When you make the baffle from the SVC, you are taking a part of the SVC and making the baffle. So it is important to see that there is no obstruction which is occurring at the level of this particular portion of the diversion of the blood. Okay?
Okay.
So otherwise, I think the analysis was fairly correct. And coming from the clinical findings, we came to a diagnosis that this is likely to be a TAPVC or a common AV canal type of defect which is coming into this thing. Yeah? Okay? Good, good. Very good. Very good presentation. Okay?
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Bye.